Okay, I was experiencing a problem before with rendering, but I'm just going to run it again. I've got a funny feeling. Yeah, that's a bit of a problem. Like, that won't help. That still didn't work, mind you. There's no way that did 9 recursions. Wow, okay, maybe it did. Let's just give it another little. I suppose it's only 4 segments, so maybe I'll just blast it all the way up before I do that. Try and get something slightly more interesting. Well, my colors. Start with a pink. Okay, well, I'll just go for. Oh no, well, I'm gonna get 9 again. Interesting. It's doing 9. Yeah. So this will take quite a bit longer. Why is it going so fast? Well, it's not adding an awful lot. Is that even? I mean, that could be right, yeah. Let me just make sure I'm getting something else. Go up to 12 recursions. So it's all short lines as well. Mean, that's an awful lot more recursions. Well, it's not really adding all that much. Let me. Yeah, I mean, that is definitely it. And it's just that one little high point, or couple, maybe. I really kind of like how much that is getting depth, though. But maybe still. Let me see. I'm not going to sit and play with it. I'm just I'm getting distracted because it really works. And actually, 12 recursions for 4 segments, it's fast. It's not having to open the window. I'm pleased with that. It's got oh, it's put itself out of the task manager. I can get it back. Windows command. Oh yeah, that's the G to cursor is there, but the renderer is not. Oh wow, that's because it's gone. And is it here? Yeah, scale value 0.8. Well, just pushed it all back a bit. I don't know, I didn't really need it. But then I do wonder what's down there. Like, what if I push it well back? Starts to get fuzzy, the middle gets a lot more, the bottom is still down there. And it's what it feels like. It feels like you're plumbing down to sea. Because I'll just fire down. One more. And then I'll think about what I've got to do next properly. Because what is it? I think it's the data buffer output. I don't think I can sort of. Well, I don't know. How much more am I going to get? It's doing 12 recursions, which is quite nice. It means there's still some sort of depth quite far into it. I do have ideas, yeah, I had pretty ideas about how quite easily to do the redistribution using a couple of passes. I mean I can't resist doing this, 'cause I wish I'd actually stuck that up to 13. I almost never go to 13 recursions. 1, 2, 3, 4, yeah. It's interesting, and you know what? I will save that one. Oh me, I've come all the way to here because it doesn't know, it forgot, of course. But I want to be in recursor things, and I want to save that as test pong. And now have a little wait while I talk about what I've got to do, which is I've got to get the data bank. First off, do I want to switch to a data bank? Do I want to compile a new renderer? Just add it to the list there. I think it'll work. And do what? Make it work with the data bank so I can do some comparisons of speeds, but almost more importantly, get that information out. Do I want to switch to a data bank? Like, one of the benefits of switching to a data bank, no, not benefits, one of the reasons I'm thinking about it just now is that it would change what I save, that's all. It's a tiny thing, really. The most important thing is getting it out. And it can just be a render data. It can be handled very much like the logs, in that the image viewer can. This is running in debug mode, isn't it? It is, that's interesting. The render's still fine, mind you. That's apparently complete. Well, don't know what to say other than, yeah, it's added a bit more deep down, but not heaps, I don't think. Yeah, really not heaps. It's hard to say exactly what it's done. I feel like I can see more color detail around here. This sort of part, a little. Then down here. Yeah, there's a little more, a little deeper, but not that much. I could probably get away with a much lighter scale. But actually, yeah, I shouldn't get bogged down in that, because if I can get the data buffer to output and get it to display, that's what I was going to say, is there can just be another button which can appear whenever it's present. When data buffer has been output. That is going to be a big thing though, when I think about it. It's like it's going to be a 2 MB file. So, I was going to say, program render needs to be in general. It's not to do with videos, it's to do with everything. Quality and keeping images, yeah, maybe. And quality should just be called file type. Just for some, that's what it really is, and it might affect the quality, but it's the file type. So, I suppose the first thing I want to do is get into render one, and I want to save that. Well, this is the thing. Like, is it actually just going to make my life monumentally easier to save a data bank, a data buffer? Let's have a little look back at the the Databuffer class, wherever it is. Let's have a look. I've really no idea. Monkey. My memory is shocked. Memory. Data buffer. Just thinking that I really think I am going to switch over to using floats to record. Anyway, save. Saves the contents of the data buffer to a file. False if path could not be opened or not all data could be written. Wow. So it just does this little thing. Anyway. See, my thing to save the array would pretty much be that, but I dare say this will be a damn sight faster. And use a data buffer. Sorry, I'm just reading this. Yeah. How can I avoid it? Like, how on earth can I avoid it? I suppose there will be some consequences. Is playing up again. Let's see. Render gradient could move back inside render really now, but anyway. Here's where it inits the array. Then afterwards is where it does stuff with the array. Hesitating here because I have two courses of action. I'm going to have to take a pause and consider. It's unusual for me to do, but I'm going to. Back instantaneously. Okay, this is going to be a strange video. I recorded the first part of it 2 days ago. I've since had a break and played with the program quite a lot. It's good fun. and playing with it has made me certain that this is the right thing to do. I mean, I'd pretty much decided, but what I've realized is that making, and well, I kind of knew this, but I've been made certain that making good looking renders is about the work you do separate to the constructing the data buffer. Defining the details of defining the gradients, the scaling, the thresholds is more important, or you know, it's much faster to do and has a huge effect on the final outcome. So I'm going to make the data buffer editor, and I'm going to make the renderer use a data buffer. So the other thing is that it's easy to rely on the compression of a video to smooth gradients that otherwise you can still see the line details in. And the line details are sometimes desirable, but often you want to get rid of them. I'd want to get rid of them in smooth gradients. And that just means more recursions, and that means huge render times really quickly. But in a way, the huge render times, that data buffer is the valuable thing. If I could get some beautiful detailed data buffers which are worth saving, because they might take 10 hours to render, but provide low, well, I say 10 hours to render, but I also do have to think about how much detail I can render in 10 hours. When will things become saturated? Anyway, the main thing is that I have to do it, and I have to think carefully about what it's actually doing, and I have been giving it some thought. One thing is, these are no longer going to be two boxes. It'll be change again, bye bye draw mode and render options, and it will just be like draw options, and you can render image or video. And there'll be a single box which I will decide the exact structure of, but in will come alongside image viewer something else called bank viewer or something like that, data viewer. And it'll work similarly to the image viewer in that when you have completed a render, opening the data viewer by default will the first thing that the data viewer opens will be the most recent render, and opening the most recent render will always be an option. So, but the other thing that I have to be clear about is what exactly I'm editing when I open the data viewer, or whatever I call it. Because what is it? I need to be able to have the unprocessed data in the memory, and I need to be able to write it to a PIX map the same way that the renderer does. And I need to be able to say view, scroll, and everything around that PIX map, and save it. And alter these values as they're applied to that data bank, data buffer. But these values that I'll be altering inside the data viewer will not be the values that are applied to the project in general. And in fact, they sort of, well, I mean, can I make them? In a way I can. But, well, what's the problem with that? Well, this animates and has all of these variety of positions. And the gradient refers to those variety of positions. What you will view inside the data viewer will not animate, it will be a static thing. I can still provide a sort of little set of information that describes it, but the gradient set will be overkill, so to speak, and I will have to, like, if this is what I'm thinking, that basically what I want to supply inside the data viewer is this set of information to be applied to the data. Does make me think I'll keep these separate for now, to be fair. One of the problems is, like, I could open a draw mode options box. No, I can't anymore. I can't anymore. I was going to say, I may be about to change this back. I could open a draw mode options box in front of the data viewer, but I can't really, because this works on the project now. Okay, well, you know, is it realistic that I say, yeah, when you're working in the data viewer, you're altering the project? Because I don't think it is. I think the point of the... Oh man, am I right about this? That the point of the data viewer? Or do I just decide, nah, when you're in the data viewer, the render options box can close. The draw mode options box stays open or is forced open. And from then on, you're still working on the... Well, I don't know. Yeah. When I think about this, actually, it's a shortcut, and it's not ideal. What I was thinking was, previously, up until more or less this moment, was you open the data viewer, which I'm going to start calling it, even though it's a bad name. You open the data viewer, and you're presented with a draw mode options box, which just has, well, what I was thinking was, you'd be presented with a draw mode options box that described what you're presently viewing. And you could alter the draw mode options, and it would be completely independent of the project. It would be the one that was associated just with the data viewer. And then there would be some way of applying the draw mode options you'd set inside the data viewer back to the project, the same way that you apply the edits you've made to a gradient set. But, when I think about it, maybe that is just extra faff, and I shouldn't really think about it that way. I should just think about it that these are your draw mode options. The data viewer is a way of tweaking them further and getting, you know, multiple still images from a single data bank. Well, I'm going to try, now that I think about it, that has a the element of simplicity about it. I can just close down certain windows whenever the data bank editor is opened and force open the draw mode options window. I can keep these separate. I was thinking previously I put them together. It feels a bit artificial of a distinction now, particularly since the contents of this window change less often. It does feel like an artificial distinction, but I suppose if there's any distinction, it's what would appear inside the draw mode options is what will stay visible when the data bank editor is open. The data buffer, the data editor, data viewer, data... I need a name for it. That was like 15, was it? 14 recursions, one of the one of the largest numbers of recursions I've done, and with an exponential scale of 0.2, scaling it exponential, 0.2, I don't know how to really phrase that, but I'm using an exponent to scale. Anyway, the point of it is I was curious to see at 0.2, because I was obviously get a lot of banding, as the low levels are just too much. But I wonder, am I just making a rod for my back, these things be integers? Is that the only, is it because they're integers, is that the only reason I'm ending up with banding at all? I just hadn't thought that through. I don't know. I don't think that's what it is. I think that these are the only two levels between these values. Or, you know, like this is... Can that really be right? Anyway, I'm getting distracted thinking about that. It's something that's easy to play with, in a way. Compared to thinking about this. But anyway, so yeah, when I get back to it, the distinction might be that, yeah, draw mode options, openable. Let me think again for a sec. So when I imagine the data bank, data viewer, I suppose I do imagine it kind of like this. Draw options open. I'll have to have a button that will allow you to open the draw options again. It'll be somewhere like this. Again, this will show either latest data bank or the name of the data bank that's loaded. I think I'm going to have to allow very similar to this. No, I can't do that. Can I? Can I have multiple data banks side by side? Having the changes. Well, what I was thinking, I initially thought I would do this because it would mean. Oh, God, what would it mean? It would just mean being able to do the same as this, being able to compare side by side. But I initially also thought that I'd be having an individual set of draw mode options effectively for each display. But if I'm deciding that when you go to the data editor you're altering the project's draw mode options, then that's not so straightforward, then, you know. Although, the benefit of being able to open two side by side and have the same draw mode options applied is that then you could perform a render at two contrasting points of your animation. And with the understanding that it would have the same draw mode options applied to both parts. And I notice that it does store the position of the single image that gets rendered. Well, yeah, I mean, okay. So, the reason I mentioned that is that if displaying multiple images side by side is useful because of being able to think about what different parts of your animation look like using the one draw setup, then making them display the aspect of the gradient that is relevant to their position is important. Yeah, but also I feel like I should have the opportunity, if I want, to display the contents of the data buffer of an individual view at any point in the gradient set. It's open. So that, partly just for the purposes of testing quickly different parts of the gradient set, but also for the purpose of me for the purpose just of rendering stills, I don't know if I'm ever going to be rendering videos with huge numbers of recursions, partly because the detail ends up getting lost anyway. I mean, I haven't really seriously experimented with lossless videos. I will have to a bit. I just don't have the hard disk space to make a focus of what I'm doing. But it takes so long to render large numbers of recursions. An hour a frame is easy on this machine. I think that was an hour. You know, it didn't produce a good result. I wasn't surprised by it was a test, but I think it was still 55 minutes or something. I will just check. Something goes strange. Where am I at? It's 3233 seconds. I will put in better logs. 53 minutes. Nearly 54. So, anyway, the point is, a lot of the benefits that I will get from having the data viewer will be about rendering stills. So, being able to play with the entire breadth of the gradient, regardless of the position in the animation that any individual data buffer was drawn from, is going to be important. So I can't be bothered moving my old tablet. So it's going to be a beautiful bit of mouse drawing. When I think about what my next project's definitely going to be a sketch pad. It's not going to be exactly beautiful, but that's what it's going to be. Actually, I'm going to do a test right now. Look at that. The way it's... look at that. Well, I did this test immediately just now because I was very curious about how the flood fill might work. I mean, I should go back to GIMP and play with the flood fill there and remind myself how good it is. But slight diversion here to say the least, when I was considering that I might make a paint program, thinking, well, some bits of it are quite easy to do, or a simple sketch program. Well, can I do a flood fill routine? Yeah, I can. I know that sort of how to write a flood fill routine. What about the edges of a flood fill routine. You know, I can make lines look okay just with simple drawing techniques, as you just paint them on. You know, they wouldn't be. I'm not talking about vector lines as bitmaps, but flood fills, producing the edges of flood fills. And I notice that this program doesn't. It doesn't do anything subtle, and it's considered good enough, I suppose. So that fills me with confidence. I actually think I might be able to do a little better than this. It'd be a bit of a tightrope, really. And anything that I code wouldn't be really clever. It would be about just making a bit of a quick guess about what might be a good pixel or two. But even so, that's an interesting thing that they went for that. But I don't blame them. But I'm sure GIMP does some, and not just GIMP, many other programs as well do cleverer things. Anyway, what sort of things do I need? There'll be the draw window, the draw options box. I need an options on off. I'm just going to go options or op. Somewhere on the screen I need a button like that. Somewhere on the screen I need some kind of slider or field, which is a position. And I'm just remembering what these are. What the position really is which part of the gradient is the data buffer to be rendered from. This data options window will belong to the entire screen. This will belong to a single window, the options button. Really, I only need one data options button, the one draw options button for the whole display. But what that means is that there has to be a button floating independent of those gadgets. The other option is that I just disable the close button on the draw options. I think actually maybe that's what I'll do. I'll force the draw options open and disable the close button. And just remember whether or not the draw options was open and return it to that state when the... Okay, so forget that. Don't need that. As always, until I'm forced not to, I'll take the path of least effort. So I need the position slider. Another thing I need to think about is, do changes that you make to the slider or the draw options occur instantly, or do I put an apply button? I think I do put an apply button, because I want to give you the opportunity to save an image. Image and load a data buffer. Excuse my lovely mouse writing. Load data buffer. I think that is how it's going to be. I think that basically if you want to... It isn't ideal, is it? What I was going to say is if you want to be exporting images from a project, you save the project, and this is the setup for how you're exporting images. save loads of projects. One of the main pieces of information in the project is your gradient setup. But I suppose I think I'm just going to stick with this. I'm going to see how it turns out. In a way, again, you know, just applying that what I just said, this will allow me to make the changes quickly, and will allow me to save the information, save the setup. I will put in saving and loading of individual gradient sets. That is important. And I'll do the same with palettes, actually, inside the color selector. Will I? Yes, I will. I think. But anyway, certainly with gradient sets. So, I will need a save image, load data buffer, apply settings, a position slider, I guess. And I suppose that I can disable the apply button until changes have been made to this or this. Excuse my mic. To the position slider or the draw options. Is there something else that I need? Most of what you set will be in draw options. And so in a sense, if you push render image, opening the image viewer and the data bank viewer should be effectively the same image. Like if the data bank viewer by default loads it up and has its position set up at the position it was drawn at, as it knows, you know, it remembers, it's inside its log, then it should look identical to what's in the image viewer. One second. Trying to figure out if abusing my microphone button is gonna make it like me. So, again, I suppose it will be fit one-to-one, load data buffer, save image, and then I think there'll have to be a close button and an add button. Oops. And well, I need a slight. Well, there'll have to be the name. And I wonder if I'll have to have the. I don't know about a log button, but an info button at least. And I need the slider and the apply button. And really, the only place I can think for them is down the bottom. Somewhere, so if that was a full screen, somewhere floating in there would be. be this, which is the draw options window. But there's something else as well. It's close button disabled. And what is the other thing? Is, yeah, I may want other options. And I'm not sure where else to put them. And also, if I put in other options, I do face the problem of making them look like these options. That's probably not the end of the world. Is it? Or is it the end of the world? It's like, actually, if I want to use a menu, then I will have to do something to... How do I put it? Like, at the moment I'd use a menu root, and it'd be fairly easy for me to apply the dark transparent costume to the menu root gadget. But getting the menu root gadget to apply the dark transparent costume to the menu gadget means going into the actual GUI code. That's okay. It's just another little sort of, you know, twizzle kind of... It's not even like a workaround, it's just an extra option being built into a gadget, which... It's not the end of the world. I suppose maybe I'll just do it, but make it a style of... Inevitably, this will mean... breaking off... Oh god... menus into different styles of menus. I really don't want to do that. I don't want to get into the habit of, for every gadget, having multiple types of gadget. But, I suppose that's the way it goes. I'm wittering, I'm just thinking, trying to think ahead, because one of the things I might want a menu for is displaying the view flat or displaying a 3D projection. A simple, very, very simple 3D, more like just a height map way of doing it. So that a... might be a way it might be drawn. I'm not going to draw it very cleverly here, but so that you can do something like that, which just forces it down at an angle and draws the pixels at a different height. A view like this should have a few options, though, ideally. Well, I'd like it to change the angle and position of the view, and to change the height scaling. Although I suppose you could just argue that the scaling is the scaling, it represents whatever is defined in the exponential value thing. But at least, well, you might want to add more. You might want to just do another level of scaling to say, show me what the, you know, I want a realistic idea of what these different values are relative to each other. So give me a top line. Or, yeah, basically, it's like, I don't know, not exactly sure how or what I'd want to set there. But the point is that the more options for this display mean more gadgets on this screen, under some circumstances. And that's not great. And that's for every instance of this display as well, bearing in mind... Mike is going insane again. Lots of gadgets on the screen, and for every instance as well, bearing in mind there may be more instances off to the side. going to make for a very busy display. Probably too busy, certainly too busy if all the, you know, the controls for how to position this. One option, of course, is that those controls are built into the onto this worktop. That's not out of the question. You know, what would it be? It could just be like a it could be made fairly simple. You know, a pair of axes with a draggable origin, a draggable angle gadget, you know, widget, a draggable height widget, all attached to that origin, and a draggable sort of not elevation, maybe sort of way of just elevation of the viewer sort of gadget to change the angle that this is drawn at, that the actual surface is drawn at. But then, you know, how far do I want to take that? It would be nice to be able to decide in a very simple way the angle of the, you know, the light source. Not that I'd be casting shadows across it, but it would be fairly easy to shade individual pixels as they're drawn. Or, not sure how I'd draw it. That's another thing I could provide multiple options for. A very simple thing to do would be just to draw columns of pixels back to front. And then for every pixel, draw a column of pixels back to front to make it look solid. I don't know. Anyway, these are the things I have to think about, the real details of what needs to go in. For the time being, I guess, really, I do want this projection view. I think partly just because it would look cool, and partly also, I mean, this is not would not be real time. Almost, the apply button would light up if I was to build the worktop controls. Say, the axis would be visible when. Excuse me. The axis would be visible at some point, I don't know. But I would have to think about that as well. But the point is, say you dragged the axis, then the apply button would become lit and could be usable, but once you'd clicked it, it would go off until you dragged the axis or one of the other gadgets again. Just like changing one of these values would light the apply button. So, really all I've done is talk and think about what this is going to have to look like. And the reason I'm not quite finished talking and thinking about it is I am thinking about this display and thinking, where would I put the control and how would I make the controls for this work? And it might just end up going somewhere stupid, like stacked in here. Really, this might be where those controls go, and the apply button might be stacked under here as well. Because there may other things may appear. A slight sort of, I don't know if a problem is the word, but using the transparent buttons is fine, and it's quite attractive when you've got something behind it to look at. But if I was to put an apply button, let's say I was to build a menu, not an apply button, a view button, and the view would be flat or projection, you know, flat or 3D projection. Isometric, maybe I'd call it. Because that's kind of how it'd be. It would be very, very simple. Would I even call it isometric? I don't know. Anyway, height map. Flat or height map. If I put a view button in and I gave it a transparent menu, if it opened on top of the other menus, it would probably end up looking pretty hideous. Really, it would only look properly clean if it opened against the backdrop that all the other transparent buttons are opened against. Which is just another annoying thing to consider. And that any transparent object, I have to consider rearranging the objects that are on the screen or something when it opens and closes. So these are things to think about. Annoying things to think about. And it means that I'm going to end up putting off the 3D view when I think about it just now. Putting off this height map projection anyway. And going with these and this and this. The name. Like written beautifully across. I think an info button, which actually I'll come to. Fit 1:1. Slider bar. Apply. Load data bank, save image, add, display. A little set, to say the least. The info button will take info. As I think about it, I think that I will save the data buffer, but I'll save the data buffer inside another object. It'll be like a data buffer file or a buffer file object. And that will, quite separate to an image log info, will just store a couple of things about the data buffer. And that couple of things will be what? Date of its creation, maybe. The number of recursions. The position in the animation that it was drawn from. That's just handy for drawing it at its, yeah, actually, you know, that's another button. It's annoying. It's probably a button that belongs at the end of the slider bar. And it's like, I can't even think what I'd put on this button. It's something which needs a big explanation, but does a tiny thing. It's like use original position or something. That's not what I put on the button. But as you know, another way of doing it is to click info and see. I suppose that I could put more into that. That button in the image viewer opens the log, but it doesn't have to open the same sort of thing here. If there's not that much info associated with this data buffer, besides the date of its creation, number of recursions used to create it, which isn't an essential piece of information, and its position, I could maybe stick some extra controls in there. If this wasn't info, just a, like, dit, you know, three dots, then I could put the information into the box that opens. But I could also stick a couple of buttons. Would they look really weird? I might be able to make them look okay, basically. Think about it. I think I would. but I could put in a couple of buttons, one of which was use original position, one of which is use original position, one of which might be stuff to do with the 3D view, some of which might be. But yeah, actually when I think about it, sticking it in there is what I'm going to do. I actually need a three dots icon. This has been a lot of wittering. Basically, this is going to be an hour-long video made over 2 days. I can hardly remember what was in the first one. And I haven't done really very much coding at all. If any. Did a little bit last time, maybe? Can't remember. I suppose I did a bit, yeah. But I will start doing the actual coding associated with opening and starting to view and save. That'll be the first thing I'll do, I guess, is go to the renderer, go to the recursor classes, create a data buffer class, or a buffer file class, maybe something that will be suitable for loading and saving with the relevant information. Anyway, I'll do that next time.